let's just pray before we get into the word. Heavenly Father, I just thank you so much for today. Thank you that we're here together, gathered in your to worship you, to honor you, to honor you. We just thank you, Lord, for everything that you have bestowed on us. We just give you praise. So, Lord, right now I just ask that your word, that you just speak through me and reach what you want to say today to the people that need to hear it, that a revelation will spark in their heart, Father God, and change will be made. And so, Father, I thank you for your word of truth in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the other day I happened to be online and looking at that platform called Quora. Does everyone know what Quora is? Have you heard of it? It's like if you don't know, it's like a question platform. People propose questions. Yeah. And other people, anyone can answer them. Anyone can answer them. So it's a little bit random. You get a little bit of far out stuff on there, but it's also interesting to read. And I was just reading through some stuff there and, just thinking about, what these people were saying. And I came across this young girl, this teenager. And for the sake of what, I'm going to say today, I'm going to call her Chelsea. I'm not going to put her name to it, but I'm going to call her Chelsea today. And she, what she had to say really piqued an interest in me because she was talking about her love for music. And I just want to share you something that she wrote. Excuse me one second. I might have to turn it the other way. We had a few technical difficulties last night. And, okay. All right, we'll see if this works. And my husband set it up on his iPad, so he does it a little bit differently. That's fine. We're good with this. All right. This is what she said. I started paying for Spotify Premium the second I got my current phone 2 years ago, spending half of my monthly allowance on it. I would have spent every cent if that's what it took. My phone shows the amount of hours I spend on each app. You know how it does? You can look at it and see where you're spending your time. And according to this, I spend approximately 2 hours a day on Quora, 2 hours a day on Hangouts, which is a social messaging platform, 1 hour a day on Instagram, and wait for it, 8 hours a day on Spotify. I spend 7 hours in school, and so for me, my waking hours in the day is about 16 hours. That means I spend every free second I have listening to music constantly. Music is the spark in my veins. I only do great things by first being inspired by a song. It brings me to life. It is my life. Which brings me to today's message. You are what you listen to. I don't know if you noticed when I was reading what Chelsea had to say, but for her, she connected that the only way she could do a great thing was to listen to this music, these influences in her life. Now, depending on what that music is, or, song is questionable, but effectively what she is saying is, unless I listen to this music, I can't do this great thing. Now, there's nothing wrong with listening to music. I love music. I listen to a lot of music. But we also still need to be discerning on what we are listening to. And it doesn't just apply to music. Because what we let come in our ears enters to our heart. And it can affect our outlook. It frames our decision making. It affects who we become. And it can dictate our future. Proverbs 27:17 is something that I think is applicable here, where it says, iron sharpens iron and one man sharpens another. And I don't know about you, I don't want someone's iron sharpening me when it's of the wrong vein, when it's of the wrong spirit. I want the truth of the word of God to sharpen me. I don't want to be blunt, I want to be sharp. And I hope you do too. Anyway, I want to turn your attention to this week's reading, where it says, which is Shalak. That's the name of the portion this week. And Shalak means send. And for those that don't know, we often springboard from the Torah, which is the first five books of the Bible, and we then jump into other areas of the Bible all over the place. We go on this massive journey, which is super fun, and this is what we're going to do this morning. Today, though, we're going to start in Numbers 13 and 14. And we pick up the story when the Lord tells Moses, as they are wandering in the wilderness, that he wants 12 people, 12 spies, one of each tribe, to go into this specific land that he has set aside for them. This promised land that he has already made a covenantal agreement with Abraham years earlier. And you'll read that back in Genesis. Now, Moses appointed these 12 spies and he gave them some directions of what he wanted them to suss out when they went into this land. A little bit like how we would be if we were going to go to another country. We would want to know some of the basics of what it's about so we know how to prepare for it. And so some of the things he asked of them to look for is, well, what is it like? What's this country like? You know, he wanted to get an idea of the people. Were they strong? Were they weak? Was there many? Was there not many? What was the land like? Was it flourishing? And he also wanted to know what the towns were like. Were they open or were they fortified? Now, I would think they're pretty understandable things to ask in that time. You think about in that period of history, that's what the kind of things you are. A bit different to what we would ask today. Okay, so these 12 spies go into the land. They're there for 40 days. They come back with the report to Moses and Aaron, but also to the whole congregation, the assembly that are there. Now, before we actually launch into what the spies' report was, I want you to look at this from a different position today. I want you to think about if you were one of those Israelites standing there waiting to hear the report from these spies, maybe waiting there in anticipation thinking, what's this promised land all about? Will I enjoy it? They have been walking around a little bit. I mean, they haven't been walking around that long, but they have been walking around a little bit. They have been grumbling a little bit. So, you know, I wonder what this will be like. So we're going to pick this up in Numbers 13:27. With what the spies have to say. And they told him, "We came to the land to which you sent us. It flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruit." So they were showing the fruit that they brought back, the bounty, which many of you know was this huge cluster of grapes that had to be held between two guys on a pole. It wasn't the small little bundle of grapes we see on the plate we have these days. This was huge. It just showed you the bounty of the land, not to mention the pomegranates and the figs and all these other things that they brought with them. Continuing in verse 28, it says, "However," and I wonder how they said, "however." Is it "however," which sounds promising, or "however"? It's your tone, isn't it? It's how we talk. Speaks to me anyway, what I know. I speak to people. I have to be mindful how I speak. Another lesson for another time. "However, the people who dwell in the land are strong, and the cities are fortified and very large. And besides, we saw the descendants of Anak there," that being the descendants of the giants. Further on in 31:33, they talk about how much stronger they are than them. It talks about how we, the Israelites, look like grasshoppers compared to these giants. And as an onlooker, I'm starting to think this report is starting to feel a little bit, I don't know. Do I want to go there? But then all of a sudden, one of the spies pipe up. He obviously could gauge the assembly and how they're responding. I reckon he was watching people's faces and thinking, well, I need to speak up. I need to speak the truth now. And his name was Caleb, and he was from the tribe of Judah. And it says in verse 30 that Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, "Let us go up at once and occupy it, for we are well and able to overcome it." It was like he was settling the people and reassuring them that God will do what he said before any full hysteria broke out. Yeah. But guess what happened? Full hysteria broke out. Yes, full hysteria broke out. Everyone around us now is they're weeping, they're crying, "Oh, we want to go back to Egypt. We want to go back from where, you know, God delivered us from. Now we'd be better back in Egypt." In the middle of all this, Caleb steps up again, and now he has a second spy, and the second spy is from the tribe of Ephraim. And together they get up and they say in Numbers 14:7-9, "The land which we pass through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. If the Lord delights in us, he will bring us into this land and give it to us, land that flows with milk and honey. Only do not rebel against the Lord and do not fear the people of the land, for they are bread for us. Their protection is removed from them and the Lord is with us. Do not fear them. And so how do you think the people responded to Caleb and Joshua giving this word of truth? They wanted to stone them. Just got worse. But as someone that is standing there, what would you believe? What would you listen to? A very wise person, my husband, when we were first married, said to me that there are three sides to a story. There's their truth, there's your truth, and then there's the actual truth. And in the case of this biblical account, do you believe their truth, the 10 spies that are very doubtful about this land? Do you believe your truth? You might be on the fence. You might be feeling a little bit of fear. I don't know. You're in the scene. Or do you believe God's truth? Despite what you see, despite what you're hearing, do you believe in God's promises? Do you believe in the covenantal agreement that God made back with Abraham in regards to the promised land? And this is what Caleb and Joshua were trying to convey to them, to the people of Israel, that God's plan was always for them to go into the promised land. You see, the 10 spies were looking at this from the ground up, a bit like how we look at everything, from a human point of view. And God saw this. It says in Numbers 14, 21, 22, "But truly as I live, and as all the earth shall be filled with the glory of the Lord, none of the men who have seen my glory and my signs that I did in Egypt and in the wilderness and yet have put me to the test these 10 times and have not obeyed my voice." Caleb and Joshua were different. And if you read further on in Numbers 14, it talks about Caleb being of a different spirit. They had a reverential awe. Caleb and Joshua had a reverential awe of the Lord, not a fear of man. And they were viewing this whole scene from the top down, how God would. And, you know, they were seeing it that this was just going to be another sign, another testimony of the glory and the greatness of God that not only is seen for the people of Israel, but also for all the other nations to see. Caleb and Joshua had not forgotten about the God of Israel and how they delivered them from the Egyptians. They had not forgotten about how God had turned up so many times, providing manna. We learned about quail yesterday, providing all this stuff. They had not forgotten that. They believed God. They listened and they obeyed what God had said through Moses about this promised land. So let's fast forward in time. 40 years later, when the Israelites are going to enter the promised land again, the process repeats itself, but this time we see two spies going into the land, specifically Jericho. And these spies seek refuge in what they thought was an inconspicuous place, that being a prostitute's house, that being Rahab's. And Rahab, being a Canaanite, hides them in her house. And so she then becomes gets questioning by the king of Jericho. King of Jericho sends men to question her about these two Israelites that have been in her house. And now she, like the midwives in Egypt, is faced with the moment of truth. The midwives in Egypt had a moment where they were told by Pharaoh they had to kill the babies when they were being born by the Hebrew ladies were birthing them. And they didn't, because they feared God before they feared man. And the same is with Rahab. Rahab defies the king and rescues the Israelites. But firstly, the question needs to be asked, why on earth is a Canaanite, a Gentile, wanting to save Israelites' lives? The answer is in Joshua 2, 9 to 11. And it says, "And said to the men," she's saying this to the two men, "I know that the Lord has given you the land and that the fear of you has fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land melt away before you." This melting away is significant, because if you go back into Exodus 15, specifically, it's the Song of Moses or the Song of the Sea, and this is when it's like a prophetic oracle that Moses is saying, after being redeemed, being rescued from the Israelites, going through the Red Sea and coming on the other side. And it talks about there that the Canaanites will melt away. And this is a Canaanite woman saying, and you'll hear more of this when we read further in Scripture, that they are melted away, this spirit, they've lost hope because they've heard about this God of Israel. Verse 10, for we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea before you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan, to Sihon and Og, whom you devoted to destruction. And as soon as we heard it, our hearts melted. That's that melting again. They lost hope. And there was no spirit left in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is the God in the heavens and on the earth beneath. In reading this, we can see Rahab functioned as a prophetic voice, anticipating Israel's occupation of the land. She didn't listen to the king of Jericho. Heck, she didn't even listen to herself. She was in a position where she probably could have been killed herself and her whole household for holding these two Israelites. But rather, she listened and believed and had a reverential awe and openly confirmed her belief in the God of Israel when she said, for the Lord your God, this is verse 11, he is a God in the, he is God of heavens above and earth beneath. She already believed in God's power. She already knew that the Israelites were going to take the land. And now she had become a significant part of this story. This Gentile woman with no knowledge and experience of the Lord God of Israel, first-hand experience, other than what she had heard, was willing to risk her life for God's chosen people. It kind of makes me think of that verse when Jesus said, blessed are those who haven't seen but believe. It's exactly that. So she puts her faith in action when she listened and believed in this miraculous power of the God of Israel. Now James, Jesus' brother, confirms this in the New Testament when he talks about a person is not justified just by faith. Works is part of this as well. James 2, 25, 26, it says, and in the same way was not also Rahab the prostitute justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out by another way? For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also is faith apart from works is dead. You know, it's interesting, and I believe it was a bit of a God thing. Funny enough, I was listening to a podcast yesterday. I don't know if you knew that this is going to be random, but Goldie Hawn, her children, Kate and Olivia Hudson, I was listening to a podcast from them. They had a beautiful Jewish lady on they were interviewing, and she was 95, and you probably know of her, Edith Eger, and she was part of the Holocaust, sadly. And she, I don't know if you knew, but Goldie actually is a Jew, and so she is a Hungarian Jew, and so that passes down. So the kids thought this was super interesting to interview this lady. What was really interesting, as she was talking through her time over in Germany and being, you know, held captive, she said, I need you to think about this. She said this a couple of times. I need you to think about this. I need you to think about this, about the righteous Gentiles and who died risking their lives for us. Yeah. Wow. And I thought, wow. Now, I don't know whether she terms righteous the same way we deem it. I'm not sure. But it was just like this mic drop moment while I'm in the car listening to it. I'm like, these righteous Gentiles. You know, she said, not all Germans were Nazis. And I think not all Canaanites were against the Jews. Wow. You know? It's good. It's really good. So let's jump ahead in time yet another 1,300 years to a time of Jesus. Sorry, did that sound a bit too upbeat, did it? Apologies. In Matthew 10, well, I'm actually not going to read, I'm just going to refer to it, but in Matthew 10, we see Jesus getting ready to send out the 12 apostles. In Matthew 10, 1, it talks about it refers to them as disciples, but when we go to Matthew 10, 2, they are now apostles. And apostles means sent ones or messengers. Shalach, exactly. I took it out because I thought maybe I'm saying it too much, but I had it all the way through saying shalach. There you go. Now in verse 12, when they were disciples up until, so what I'm trying to say, they were disciples and then they became apostles. The terminology changed because they sent out. But when they were disciples, they had been learning from Jesus, right? watching, listening, taking it all in. A bit like when you guys go up to Pastor Kyle saying, what about this? What about that? Or Pastor Greg. Or when we're in life group and we're asking each other questions. Or when you ask the Holy Spirit something and he leads you something in the Bible. You're learning and you're listening. And you're hearing and seeing the power of God. And just like Moses did, you know, in Numbers 13, Jesus lists the 12 apostles in Matthew 10. Just like Moses did, Jesus gives them a list of instructions that they are to do when they are sent out as apostles. A couple of the key ones was that they were to go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, the Jewish people. It wasn't the time for the Gentiles, although they probably got picked up on the way at points, but it wasn't the time for the Gentiles. It was the Jewish people. The apostles were given the power from Jesus to heal the sick, cleanse the leper, and to cast out demons. And they were to declare, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Meaning the Messiah who the prophets had prophesied, years before had now been revealed in flesh. The promised Redeemer. They had a promised land. This is a promised Redeemer. You have been looking for, praying for, is walking amongst you. And so now it was time for these disciples to stop, to step up out as apostles. Now it was time that they were going to become who they listened to. Yeah. So they were going to listen, or were they going to listen to the criticism of their family? Because if you continue to read in chapter 10 of Matthew, you'll actually see other specifications. They weren't to take certain things with them. And I was thinking about it, and I thought they'd be going home to their family or their loved ones going, okay, I've got to go out. Jesus has told me I've got to go out. And if they were still living in their mother's house or with their wife, can you imagine the mum's going, now you need to take a change of clothes. Were they going to listen to that and hold them back? And oh, I really should take a change of clothes and maybe, you know, maybe I shouldn't go. Were they going to listen to their own self-doubt? Or were they going to listen to the Son of the living God and become what he says? You see, the parallel between these accounts of Moses and the 12 spies, Rahab and the two spies, and Jesus and the 12 apostles is to do with this promised land, with Jesus' mission. It was to do with the kingdom of heaven. You see, the promised land is like a metaphor or symbolizes the kingdom of heaven. Now, for Moses and the 12 spies, it affected whether they lived and died and who went into the promised land. That is, whether they listened and believed in the covenant-keeping God of Israel or not. For Rahab and the two spies, because she heard and believed of the power and the might of the God of the Israelites, as a Gentile, her faith grafted her spiritually into Israel. Yes. And the genealogy of Jesus. And yes, we see that in Matthew 1:5. She is in the listing of Jesus' genealogy. Yes. She and her family then actually lived in the midst of Israel in the promised land, which is a beautiful example of what is available for Gentiles entering into the kingdom of God through the promised Jesus. And for the 12 disciples, well, this affected the living world from there on. Those who did repent would enter the kingdom of God, enter the kingdom of heaven through the promised Messiah, eternity. Death would have no hold on them, but sadly many different. And you could say they are still in a spiritual wilderness today until Messiah comes again. Who the disciples listened to changed history at that time, and it continues today. What a pivotal point in time. What a pivotal point in time. So what became of Joshua and Caleb for listening to God's truth? Well, Joshua was promoted and commissioned to lead Israel into the promised land. Caleb, I've taken a liking to Caleb in this whole scenario. I think it's amazing. It said after he got into the promised land, he asked for his inheritance, even though he was now 85 years old. Because remember, because they did not believe and go into the promised land, they had to walk around for 40 years. He was part of that. Him and Joshua were the only ones that could go in. I won't go into that, but they were the only ones that could go. You need to get on the Torah portion to get details more on that. But, you know, they were the ones that could go in. And it says, even though he was 85 years old, he conquered his inherited piece of land, Hebron. I know, Hebron, which was literally the place where the giants resided. And you know what I love about this? If you read, it's either Joshua 13 or 14, this account. What I love about this is that he's like, yep, I want my piece of land that I've asked for, and I'm going to go in there because I'm still strong at 85 years old. And I think that is actually trifecta. I think that's strong physically, I think that's strong mentally, but I think that's strong spiritually, because he knows the God of the heavens and the earth, the God of Israel, is with him.
Yes.
Just as he knew 40 years earlier.
Right.
And I think, wow, are we like that? Do we grow in strength as we get older, or do we just sit complacent? Food for thought. Food for thought for myself too. As for the 12 disciples, all but one were martyred, but Revelation reveals their reward. In Revelation 6:9, it says, when he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the witness they had borne. We go to verse 11. It says, then they were each given a white robe, told to rest a little longer until the number of their fellow servants and their brothers should be complete, who were to be killed as they themselves had been. So what's significant about the white robes? Well, in Revelations 19:8, it defines the white linen robes as righteous acts of the saints because they listened to the God of Israel.
Yes. That's good.
So I've got a few questions for you as we end. Who are you listening to? Are you listening to the masses? Are you listening to your own self-thoughts? Are you even listening to, and don't take this the wrong way, the Christian masses of what is acceptable in Christendom, which contradicts the word of God? Because it happens. And there might be some of you here thinking, that doesn't add up where I went there the other week. What is that? You need to dig deep and find out what the answer is. Are you walking by faith in fear of spiritual things of God, or are you focused on the earthly things of this world? Like Chelsea that I mentioned earlier, does music and things of this world help you do great things? Or is God and his spirit taking you onto great things beyond your wildest imagination for his glory and not for yours? The last couple of weeks I had a picture that I feel the Lord gave me, and it's actually of marshmallows, more specifically s'mores. I don't know if you guys have the picture that you can put up behind me, but basically it was a s'more. Does everyone know what a s'more is? If you don't, you'll see it in a second. There we go. And basically it's a marshmallow, and in America they say, and you put two Graham biscuits around either side of it, but Graham in America, in Australia, is more granita. That's what they are. It's the equivalency. I've got the shaking yes, that's right, Kelly, from Michelle. So you basically toast your marshmallow and you put it between these two biscuits. And I felt like the Lord was saying to me that we're marshmallows. This is for the whole church. We're marshmallows. And if you look at it, this one's prodded and it's put on fire. Refined, probably, but also a bit, you know, a bit skew-whiff and a bit off. But that's okay, because God wants to use you, right?
That's awesome.
And then the biscuits, I feel like the Lord was saying, represented the Holy Spirit that lives and resides in you, one side, protecting you. The other side is the Word of God, is truth. And he wants you to be used for his glory. He wants you to listen to what he is saying to you. And I want to ask anyone here that feels like maybe you're lacking courage, fearful to act on... Sorry, I just looked at the prop down here. It's just a natural reaction. What are you doing? Sorry. Events. I've got an events background. Fearful to act on God's voice and prompting, I want to pray for you. If that's you, where you're scared to step up and step into, then come down the front and let me pray for you. I had an example the other week, very quickly. I spoke to a girl, randomly talking, She asked what I did, told her. She said, I'm seeking the Lord. And I said, okay. I knew the whole time that the Lord was speaking to me that I'd pray for her. Didn't know how I'd segue into it without segueing into it appropriately. And I said to her in the end, I said, look, can I pray for you? She goes, yeah, but do you believe, are you one of those Christians that are anti-gays and believe they shouldn't be doing what they're doing? Because I can't stand that. And I'm holding her hands at this point, ready to pray for her. And I'm like, okay. And I had to know, I had those 3 points come up in my head. What do I choose? Her truth, where love is love. My truth, where I know the word of God. But I also was thinking, truth be told, what is she going to say to me? How is she going to react when I speak to her the truth? That was my thought. That was my honest thought. Or God's truth. We know what God's truth says about, which is in his word. And you know what? I chose God's truth, of course. I spoke sensitively and appropriately to her. It's those kind of situations where God wants you to listen to him, to shine his glory, to speak the truth. Because the thing is, we're in a world today where more than ever we need to. We need to. And I'm not talking about destruction happening in third world civilization. I'm talking about Western civilization. It is just self-destructing. But God's bigger than all that.